Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I am getting prepared to go live. I'm going to do a little bit of praise and worship before we get started. But I'm coming on and I'm looking forward to seeing each and every one of you as we share the word of God. We talk about God's giving grace. So I'm just going to listen to a little bit of praise and worship in the meantime. As those of you who are coming on, join me.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I just thank you and praise you for this opportunity to just have you come in to share your word, to teach line upon line and precept upon precept, that those things that would be considered mysteries you make clear, Father. I thank you that you give me grace to speak your word with clarity, that those people that hear your word will be blessed. We thank you for everybody who's joined us today for this message. And I thank you that there be a blessing and an anointing in this word for them, that their lives will be changed for the better. So, Father, we just thank you and praise you for everything that you've done and continue to do, not only in this ministry, but in the lives of those people who are partaking. And we just thank you for their faithfulness right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much for coming out today to join us for this word. And I have been teaching the book of Romans. I taught the book of James, all five chapters, and then I rolled into Romans because God was placing on my heart to deal with this issue of salvation. But he needed to build a foundation and give us an understanding of what was happening during the time that Paul was speaking. First of all, Paul was speaking to Christians. He was not speaking to people who were not saved. He was speaking to people who were saved and persecuted. The issues that he dealt with in the book of Romans was specifically dealing with Christians and their attitudes towards people who were not saved, had not accepted Christ, or had some alternative issues in reference to their confession of belief. So they confess that they believe in Jesus Christ and that he died for their sins. But what happened was their lifestyle did not reflect that. And so he was dealing with all of these issues in the book of Romans. And as I was getting into the groove of things, God kind of pulled the emergency brake. And he said to deal with this issue of God's favor, God's giving grace. And when he gave me this message, the thing that I thought about in reference to God's giving grace is I thought about Abraham. And in the Old Testament, his name is Abram before God changed his name to Abraham. And I looked at his life and the things that he's done. He's considered the father of faith based on the things that he did in the word and the demonstration of his faith through his actions. And a lot of people think that in the Old Testament that he gained his righteousness based on his actions. And he was the one that was given the command to have all men to be circumcised. And he started with his family. And so that act of doing the circumcision was supposed to be an act to reflect salvation. And many times people think that the act of circumcision made you saved. No. The faith of the command of God caused the men to then act out and follow the instructions of God in being circumcised. And that was a demonstration of their faith and belief. So the circumcision did not represent salvation. The faith in what the circumcision represented gave them their salvation in the Old Testament. And Abraham, as a man of God and a father of faith, demonstrated not only that, but many other things that we will, some of which we'll get into tonight. Once again, the message is God's giving grace. And one of the things that I wanted to start with was a statement about Abraham. It was his faith that brought him favor with God. It was his faith that brought him favor with God. It was demonstrated through his actions. And because of that, God made a covenant with him. At the time, his name wasn't Abraham, it was Abram. We're going to go to Genesis chapter 15 to talk about exactly what happened. And this was God's promise, and God promised a son to Abraham. It says, after these things, this is Genesis chapter 15, verse 1. I think I'm going to go through verses 1 through 5 to give it some context. So it says, after these things, the word of God came unto Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abraham, or Abram, I am thy shield, thy exceeding great reward. And Abram said, Lord God, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and a steward of my house is this Eleazar of Damascus? And Abram said, behold, to me thou hast given me no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir. And this is where God gives him the promise. He says in verse 4, and behold, the word of God came unto him, saying, this shall not be thine heir, but he shall, but he that shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be thine heir. And he brought him forth abroad and said, look now towards heaven and tell the stars if thou wilt be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be. And he, Abraham, believed the Lord, and he counted him for righteousness. So God counted him for righteousness because he believed in God and what God said. So Abraham was given a promise. His promise came because of his faithfulness. He had already demonstrated to God that he was faithful to what God said. God said, Abraham, leave your family, leave your father and mother, and go to the place which I tell you. Abraham didn't know where to go, but he said, okay, God, I will go. And he went. And then from there, he continued to show his faith as he went through to different towns and places and did exactly what God called him to do. So what's the issue? The issue is that Abraham's faith is what allowed God to give him favor. His faith was demonstrated through his actions, and God gave him favor. Well, already was showing him favor, but as he continued to show that he was obedient to what God said, God continued to furnish and brandish favor and grace over him in his life. So what came first, the faith or the promise? That's a good one. It's like, what came first, the chicken or the egg? Here's what came first. Abram believed God and acted according to the things that God said first. God then responded with favor and grace and continued favor and grace throughout his life because of his obedience. Because at the time, there were not many people who followed the word of God and who did or followed the instructions that God gave him. So as we move forward, I talk about a couple of points God made. He said to Abraham, or Abram at the time, God is your shield, or I'm your shield to Abram. So that meant wherever he went, God was his protection. He also said, he also gave him a promise. He gave him a promise because of his demonstration of his faith, or a demonstration of his belief in him. And due to Abram's faith-filled lifestyle, then God called him righteous. So God called him righteous because of the faith that he continually demonstrated. Now, what's different in the New Testament for us and what was apparent to Abraham at the time was that God called him righteousness because of his faithfulness, and his faith is what granted the righteousness. For us, what we are granted a gift that automatically gives us righteousness and justification. All we have to do is reach out and receive it. But how do we receive it? We receive it the same way that Abram did, through faith. So Abraham demonstrated his faith throughout his life, and that gave him righteousness, or God counted him righteous because of his demonstration. We get it as we demonstrate our faith in what Jesus Christ did. We get that righteousness and justification when we demonstrate our faith by confessing Jesus Christ as Lord, believing he died for our sins, and for that reason we are saved. Now, here's the challenge that I have. If we believe what we confess, if we believe Jesus Christ died for our sins, then what is our struggle? So I'm gonna go to Hebrews 11, and I'm gonna go to verse 8, and then I'm gonna jump to 17 and 19. And we're gonna talk about first, what was the promise? And second, I'm going to illustrate what our challenge is. Oh, just so you know, I'm using the real Bible. So I'm going to start off with Hebrews 11, starting at verse 8. And starting at verse 8, it says, "By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out to a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, he obeyed, and he went out not knowing whether he went." So this is a demonstration of what he did in Genesis when God said, "Go out, go to this land in which I'm going to call you," and he went. That was the first demonstration of faith. And then if we go down to verse 17 through 19, it says, "By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac." Isaac was his son, the promised son that God promised him back in Genesis 15. He was the promised son. He offered him up, even though God promised that Isaac's seed was going to populate the world and his descendants would be as many as the stars in the sky. So we would think that there is a contradiction here, but really it's a demonstration of Abraham's faith because he believed, like he always has, in God's promise. What I found out is that the promise that he made, and which was really cool, because this really showed how much faith he had, and I didn't see this at first. Because of his faith, and as we read, it says, "By faith Abraham, when he was tried up, he offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promise offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called, accounting that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, from whence also he received him in a figure." So this is what that scripture is telling me. That's verse 17 through 19. It's Hebrews 11, 17 through 19. What that's telling me is that Abraham, at the time that God commanded him to sacrifice his son, he believed that he was going to sacrifice his son, but he also believed that God could raise him up from the dead. He was willing to give up his only begotten son, his promised son that God promised him, promised that the seeds were going to populate the world from. He was willing to give up that seed to and believe that God could raise him from the dead because he also remembered what God promised him. I thought that was awesome. And so that's why he's called the father of faith. And the faith that he showed was the same faith that God showed to us, the grace and favor that he gave us in his sacrifice of his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. So as I was going through this, I said, okay, so what's our problem? Abraham is demonstrating extraordinary faith. He's believing the promises that God said to him, and he's acting accordingly. So that means that faith is demonstrated by actions. What came first, faith or the promise? The promises for us came first. God promised many things in the Word of God well before we were born. And he also gave his only begotten son as a sacrifice. So for us and for Abraham, the promise came first. God was already prepared to promise Abraham. Abraham just demonstrated his belief in God so that when the promise came, for us, it shows us that his corresponding actions to his belief continue to grant him the promise of God, the favor and the grace of God that he needed to get through life successfully. So, what is our issue? What is it that we're challenged with, or what is it that we're struggling with that causes us not to continue to demonstrate our belief truly in what God said and what he can do for us. And here's what I saw. I saw that, first of all, do we really understand what God said and what we're supposed to do? So I'm going to go to Romans. This is a very popular scripture to be read often. Romans 10, starting at verse 9. And I'm going to read all the way down to verse 13 because there's revelation in this reading in reference to what this truly says. And it says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and thou shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. That is not a question, that is a statement. It says, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness. So now, Abraham believeth, and his actions showed what he believed, and God called him righteous. The same as it says right here, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So before you can make the confession of Jesus Christ, your heart already has to be turned. You already have made the commitment and belief in your heart of what God is truly saying. The confession comes after the demonstration. It is a byproduct of your faith. Just like for Abraham, when God told him to do something, because he was already convinced and believed God, he moved based on what God said. And because he moved based on what God said, guess what? He was counted righteous. Just like if we believe what Jesus Christ said, what God said, and the sacrifice that he made, and then we have a corresponding action that follows, then we'll be accounted, we'll be granted the righteousness based on the demonstration of our faith. I'm going to go on. It says, for the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed, for there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that calls upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So this solves the issue. I was asking, what's our problem? Part of our problem is that we don't feel like that we are justified, we are worthy of the promise that God gave us, because we think that we have to pay for it. But it's a gift. And a gift is only a gift if it's given. If you hold on to the gift, then it's nothing but a present. God didn't hold on to the gift. He gave it to us. We just have to reach out and receive it. And by reaching out and receiving it, we automatically are called righteous because the act of reaching out to receive it demonstrates our belief. And here's the other problem. If you don't think you're worthy, because he was talking to saved people and unsaved people, he was basically telling anybody who reads, this is how you become saved. Now, why would he tell a Christian, what do you need to do to be saved? Because we may think that we're saved and not be sure. So sometimes we have to be reminded of exactly what his word says so that we can be saved and so that we can really walk in it, because the issues of the world continue to compound on us and cause us to waver in our walk with God that would not demonstrate the faith that we believe or that we should believe. And that's an issue. Why do we need to waver? Because the gift was given freely and it was given to all of us. So don't get hung up on what your background was. Don't get hung up on the issues that you dealt with or the issues that you're dealing with, because I have an answer for that too. So as we move on, Abraham believed God and demonstrated his belief with a corresponding action. This is the essence of faith. Faith demonstrated pleased God. And Abraham obtained favor with God because of his faith. How are we demonstrating our faith in God and his promise? That's a self-evaluation question. But here's the truth of the matter. I, every day, struggle with that question. How am I demonstrating my faith and my belief in God? Because sometimes little things come up that cause us to question a waiver. When things don't work out the way that we think that they should, we think for some reason we've fallen out of favor with God, and we don't understand that, guess what? Sometimes we just deal with challenges because God believes that we're strong enough to get through. He doesn't allow us to enter into a challenge that we're not already equipped to win. We just don't know that we're equipped to win. It's just like anything else. If you've never ran track, if you've never raced anybody, and you don't ever get into a race, you will never know how fast you are. You may be faster than everybody else, but if you never get into the race, if you never try it, guess what? You'll never find out what you're capable of if you've never lifted weights before. Anything that you've never done in your life, you'll never know what you can accomplish if you don't try it. That's why part of our challenge is understanding that even though we're saved by grace, we deal with this issue of the flesh. And the word tells us that we've conquered flesh, but we don't necessarily know and believe that we've conquered flesh. So our corresponding action is a struggle with the things that the flesh brings upon us, because we don't know that we've already overcome it. We don't know that we have the power to overcome it. That's why tests come to prove to us that we have overcome it. And if we haven't overcome it, God says, okay, you're a work in progress. You're being perfected through these challenges and trials and tests. You need to know where you are so that you need to know what you need to work on and where you need to go. If we were never tested, then we would never know what we're capable of. Think about it. If you were never tested, you would never know what you were capable of. And God has made us capable of great things. We just need to figure it out. Why? Because there's a world out there that needs us to talk about the good news and talk about the challenges that we've dealt with and the things that we've overcome and how we were able to make it. Because if it wasn't for Jesus, if it wasn't for God and his love, I don't know where I would be. And I know some of you probably feel the same way. Here's the thing. As I was going through this, I started thinking about confession. I started thinking about the things that we say and the things that we believe. And so I was going through scriptures and I said, what holds us up sometimes from confessing and believing in God? Sometimes it's our sin. And so God had an answer for that. In Romans 8:1, it says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. I'm not going to stop there. It says, for the law of the Spirit of life in Jesus Christ hath made us free from the law of the sin of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sent his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemn sin in the flesh. So if you think that your issue, you confess Jesus Christ, but you still deal with the issues of the flesh, and you think that for some strange reason that the word doesn't apply to you, and that you still have to follow the pattern of the things that you felt comfortable with and the things that you've done time and time again, guess what? The word tells you, you are therefore no longer under sin. But guess what? If you don't believe that, just like you had to believe Jesus Christ is Lord and you had to believe the promise, if you don't believe that you're no longer under sin, if you don't believe that you have the power to overcome sin nature, then guess what? You're going to constantly succumb to sin. Why are we tested? So that we can prove to ourselves that we're no longer subject to the sin that so easily besets us. That's what it is. So guess what? You think trials and tests are punishment, but trials and tests are really victories set up for you already. Every test and trial that you go through is a setup for you to win. But if you don't believe that you're no longer subject to sin and that you have to succumb to the pressures of sin and flesh, then you will give up before you win. you have to have just as much faith in the word of God as you do in Jesus Christ. Because we can believe Jesus Christ, but if we don't believe and understand his word, we'll fall subject to things the devil will fool us into believing that we are victims instead of victors. See, sometimes we don't fully accept what God has done for us because we think we're not worthy. How do we know? Because it's evident in our actions and our devotion to giving in to the flesh constantly. So what we truly believe is always evidenced by corresponding actions. So if you want to know where you really stand in regards to sin, watch what you like. Watch what you do. Watch what you follow. Watch what you succumb to. Watch what you constantly trip over. And watch even what you say and what you entertain with your friends. Watch the things that the world says is good and how you tend to gravitate to that because it feels good. And look at what you're trying to justify in your life. That's how you figure out what's really going on. So these actions prove that we're still struggling with our flesh and in our spirit when really we don't have to. So I'm going to go to Romans 6. As I was thinking about this, I'm going to start at verse 12 and then I'm going to go to 14. It says, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the lust thereof. Neither yield your members as an instrument of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourself unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members an instrument of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. Remember, this message is God's giving grace. He's given us grace in every situation and circumstance. He's given us the ability to overcome sin through his word based on our confession. He's made promises to us in his word that he has to stand up for. He has to be proven true in order for us to know that God is who he says he is. Bottom line. So here's the thing. God has already given us salvation and grace, and we get it as we journey through, make the right decisions. And if we make a mistake, he's even given us a tool called repentance so that we can be perfected unto him. What repentance does is it allows us to see our flaw. It allows us to say, okay, God, I know I struggled and I failed at this, but I want to give it to you and I want to repent from what I did because I was no longer subject to it, even though I gave in to it. So I'm going to repent to you for what I did. I know you're not going to condemn me for it. As long as I repent, I'm going to repent from it. I'm going to turn away from it. I'm going to move away from that and no longer fall subject to it because I learned my lesson. And I'm going to continue to focus on you and move in the plan and purpose that you've created for me. That's what he did. So what does repentance do for us? Let's look at a couple of scriptures. I'm going to go to Matthew 4. Matthew 4. I'm just going to go through a couple of scriptures. I don't want to flip too many pages. I'll flip right past it. Matthew 4. I'm just going to read verse 17. Matthew 4, verse 17. And it says, get there eventually. And it says, from that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So Jesus is saying, repent, because the kingdom of heaven is at hand. He was here. How much more is the kingdom at hand since he died for our sins? Luke 24:46. Luke 24. Luke 24:46. Matthew 24:46. And it says, "And say unto them, thus it is written, and thus it is behoved Christ to suffer and to raise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem." So this scripture is just illustrating Jesus died to allow repentance to come in, and he wants us to preach it. Now, you may not be a preacher, but he wants you to share the good news of repentance to people who are still struggling, so that they have the strength to accept what Jesus Christ did for them. I'm going to go to Luke 5 and 31, 32. Luke 5, 31, 32. I just want to give you some scriptures to talk about repentance so that you see what it is, why it was given to us, what his intent was for it. Verse 31, Luke 5, verse 31, and it said, Jesus answering said unto them, "They that are whole need not a physician, but they that are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." So if you have sin in your life as a Christian, or people out in this world have sin in their life, Jesus came not to the people who got it all together. He came to us that are struggling, that are still dealing with the issue of sin and working to overcome it. He came for sinners to repent. Now, I know it's hard to think that there's a Christian out there that's still dealing with sin, but we have a false idea that because we are saved, we are no longer, the word says we're no longer under sin, but our faith does not demonstrate that we believe that. And so we deal with issues. I mean, none of us are perfect. So even as a Christian, we still sin. There are still things that we do, whether we're aware or not, that we need to repent from once we realize and find out that we actually did engage in something sinful. Now, there's a difference. Well, really, there's not a difference. Even if you do something wrong, you still have made the confession. You still believe in your heart. Now, you definitely need to repent, get on your face and turn away from that thing so that you can get yourself realigned with the favor of God, because it's like taking a gift and then giving it back. So if your life is not demonstrating that you believe that Jesus died for your sin, then you need to do something to get yourself aligned so that your life demonstrates that you believe what Jesus did for you. I'm going to go back to the book of Acts, chapter 3. Well, actually forward to the book of Acts, but I'm going to go to the book of Acts, chapter 3, and I'm going to look at verse 19. And it says, "Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord." So this once again is telling us to repent therefore and be converted. So once again, if you're a sinner, repent, turn away from your sins, confess Jesus Christ as Lord. If not, if you are saved and you're dealing with sin, repent. Turn away from your sins so that your sins will be blotted out, so God won't remember them anymore. So that when you are presented to God, that you will be cleansed and free from sin. I'm going to go to Acts 20, verse 21. Acts 20, verse 21. And it says, "Testify both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance towards God and faith towards our Lord Jesus Christ." Testify, that means tell. Both, and it said testify, which is funny because the first part of testify is test. That means you're actually giving a testimony of the goodness of God when you're telling both Jews and Gentiles, repent towards God and faith towards our Lord Jesus Christ, have faith towards our Lord Jesus Christ. When you're telling your story and you're giving them the good news, you are testifying both to the Jews and to the Greeks. Greeks at that time were considered Gentiles as well, of the goodness of God. Last scripture I'm going to go to is Romans 2 and 4. I'm just going to touch upon this one real quick. Because once again, we have to know that, yeah, even though the word tells us that we've overcome sin, just like it took faith to confess Jesus Christ as Lord, it takes faith to believe that we are no longer subject to these issues. So, 2 verse 4 says, or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. So in this scripture, it's talking about, well, let me go back a little bit so I can put it in context. It says, and thinkest thou this, O man, that judgest them which should do such things and doest the same, and thou shalt escape the judgment of God? That's a question. He says, or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance? So basically this is saying, look, understand, you who judge other people, understand that if you judge other people and you don't understand that the repentance of God leads, I mean, the goodness of God leads to repentance, you have a problem. You have a problem. So he created us a way in which we could be tested and get ourselves right. And he also created a way for us, if we know that we're dealing with sin and we have issues, to come out from under that burden through the word of God. He gives us a method, if we make a mistake or stumble along the way, to get ourselves back together and on the right track. So where are you? Are you demonstrating your faith and your belief in the word of God? Are your actions and your professions demonstrating what you truly believe? That's the question. Are you repenting sincerely to God? Again, it is not because of your actions that you are saved, like working a job. It's not that that causes you to be saved. It's the willingness to confess that demonstrates your faith in God, because you can't make the confession without the belief. And it's a heart condition, so you can't believe in your heart without already making the decision that is true. You're just acting out what you believe when you make the confession. So is your confession, is your profession, is the things that you're doing demonstrating that you believe that God died for you and that he saved? And if you have not made the confession, then guess what? You have time to do so. You have time to do so. Remember, I read Romans 9 and 10, and I'm going to read it for you again so you know. And if you have not made this confession, you should. Once again, verse 9 says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. If you will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus. Now, how can you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus if you don't already believe him? You can't and you won't do that. So the confession comes from a change in your heart condition that agrees with what you believe God did for you. And then the corresponding action is what you're doing right here, the confession. If you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness. So believing causes a corresponding action which leads to righteousness. And with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. It's no mistake that the scripture lines it up that way, that it says that there's a heart condition that changes, that causes you to make a confession, that causes you to believe in your heart. Then out of your mouth, you confess what you feel in your heart. For with the scripture, whosoever believe on him shall not be ashamed, for there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord, over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of Jesus shall be saved. If you have not made that confession, you should. Why? Because I can tell you in my life, I've struggled. It took me 30 years to really decide to truly be for God. Now, my grandmother, when I was young, used to tell me about God all the time, and I believed in Jesus Christ. I just didn't believe enough to make the confession. I was aware of God. I knew he was real. I seen things that would cause me to believe that he was real, but it wasn't so real that it made me make a true confession in my heart. So it wasn't until I was 30 years old, challenged and struggling and wanting to change in my life, that caused me to dedicate myself to church so that I could understand and really learn about who God was, who he was to me, and who I was to him. And I would encourage you, if you're in a similar situation, no matter the length of time, you need to make that confession. Like I said, it took me 30 years to do that. And then for the next 10 years after that, I struggled with things that I had struggled with before, and challenges in my life and baggage and bones in my closet and things that I never dealt with in life. Those things came back and I had to deal with them. And some of them I failed at. Even after I made the confession, I failed at it. And I had to repent for those things, constantly repent. And move to walk away. I had to change situations. I had to move away from people so that I wouldn't succumb to certain issues and things. I had hurt in my life that I had never forgiven people from, and I had to forgive. And that was one of the biggest things that held me up. For 10 years, I learned about what God said, and I learned about who I really was after I made the confession and the challenges that I had to deal with. Now, even after that, even when I started walking the walk of Christ, after the first 10 years, you think it would have gotten easy. No, there was more challenges to come. And there were times that there were things that I had dealt with in the past that I had overcome that came back to tempt me again. But this time, because I had already dealt with that, I had already been down that line. Guess what? I was able to stand firm in what I believe and start to demonstrate the faith that I truly said that I have. And now it's 17 years I've been saved. 17 years. I can honestly say over the past 2 to 3 years that I feel much better about my walk with Christ, even though I still know that I have things that I have to work on. The walk is a day-by-day, step-by-step process. It's one day at a time, one step at a time, one sin at a time to overcome, one sin at a time to say, no, you don't have any power over me. I don't have to succumb to you. I am not subject to you. God's word told me so. And I have the ability and the strength to overcome you. And then in that test, when you overcome it, then you can praise God and say, God, your word is true. What you said is true. I have truly overcome that issue. I was successful this time. And if it comes back again, I believe I'll be successful again. Because the devil is tricky. He'll throw things at you when you least expect it, when you're in the most vulnerable circumstances and situations, to see what you'll do then. First it was, I'm going to throw it at you because I don't really believe that you really believe what you said. And he'll throw things at you, and because you really don't know whether you believe it or not, you'll fall to it. But after that, it's even after you're walking the walk, the temptations will become stronger, and they'll come in different ways. And he'll try to come around the corner, sneak around the corner on you and catch you when you're most vulnerable to trip you up. But guess what? Glory be to God, but that his word is true. And that as you continue to walk his walk and walk in his word and learn what his word says, be committed to studying his word, get in a Bible teaching church where they're teaching you the word and not just making you feel good every Sunday, where they're preaching something that's going to change your life, where they're giving you the building blocks to make your life better and successful. When you do that, then guess what? You'll start to see a change in your life. You'll start to do things that you never thought you could do before. And guess what? Glory be to God that when you do it, the change happens. And when the change happens, you'll feel good about yourself because you'll realize that everything that God said about you good is true. even the things that you didn't believe. And people will start to say different things about you because they'll start to see the light shining from you. And they'll wonder what has changed in your life. And you won't even realize there's some things that you won't even deal with because you're so far removed from it, it's not even an issue anymore. The very things that the people that are closest to you knew you were struggling with, that they'll be able to see the difference in your life. And guess what? That's when you'll realize how real God has been and how far you have come. But don't ever be deceived. You still have to work every day by day, step by step, to move forward, to show, not to God, because God already knows, but to yourself that you truly believe what the word says. See, here's the funny thing. The belief is not for God. God already knows what your heart is. The belief is for you. Faith is demonstrated by what you believe. If you believe it's a red light and you shouldn't cross the street, you won't. If you look at the red light, no, you shouldn't cross the street, but believe you can get through it, you will. And guess what? Whatever is going to happen based on the decision that you made. There's never a change in faith. Faith is not positive or negative. It is what it is. It is what it is in that moment. Today, you might believe that you can overcome, you can lift 100 pounds, but until you get in the gym, you have to press it over your head. You might believe that you can do it up to the time that you actually do it. Then when you do it, then you will know that you did the action to prove what you believed. And that's how it is. So I want you to know, guess what? This word is true and is real for you. God's giving grace. God is so awesome that he gave us his word so that we could understand exactly what it is that he's done for us. And when you believe his word and when you act upon his word, there is going to be a corresponding action because his promises are true. And when our actions demonstrate our faith and we basically put ourselves in line for the grace and the righteousness that he's given us. We don't get it if we don't accept the present. We got it, but we miss it for ourselves. We give it away because we don't believe that we have it when we approach challenges and situations and circumstances. And most of the time we don't believe because it's something in our life that we think is so bad or something that we've just done that would cause God to turn his head away from us when all we need to do once we realize that is repent. And know that God's favor is still there for us. I'm telling you guys, I've lived this and continue to live it on a day-to-day basis. This is true. If you make the confession, if you're struggling, don't worry about the struggle. Continue to move forward. Remember this last thing as I part. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the lust thereof. Neither yield your members as an instrument of unrighteousness unto sin, but as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. God bless you tonight. I hope this word has been a blessing to you. Join us here on Thursday nights. We're on Daystar Church campus, celebrating the Lord, celebrating his word, growing one to another so that we can do the work that he's called us to do. Come join us. God bless you. Good night.
Yeah, what is this?
What is this, man?
sing with. Man, I'm old school, man. I'm 53 years old.